Everyone, welcome back to our ND Line online series. This month we'll be discussing texts of Mao Zedong, and today we are going to be discussing combat liberalism, one of the limang gintong silahis, or five golden rays. And once again, we've got Tito Jo with us to give us more insight into this text. Hello, Tito.
Warmest greetings to you, Edna, and to all our listeners. I thank all of you for being with me and for having me, of course, in this episode on combat liberalism.
You're welcome. We're glad to have you. So let's start right away, shall we? So our first question, what is the context of combat liberalism? What circumstances brought Mao the need to write this?
Mao wrote Combat Liberalism in 1937 in Yan'an in the course of the campaign on theoretical and political education. There were conditions of truce between the Chinese Communist Party and the Kuomintang after the signing of the Second United Front against Japan in December 1936. It was republished in 1942 in connection with the rectification movement in Yan'an. You see, the Chinese Communist Party took advantage of the early years of the United Front with the Kuomintang against the Japanese invasion. And so they focused on theoretical and political education in Yan'an. The short article focuses on the individualistic conduct and selfish behavior of some party members who run afoul of the collective and the principle of democratic centralism. The social basis of this unhealthy phenomenon within the Communist Party is the petty bourgeoisie. Certain members join the party but continue to carry with them petty bourgeois tales and need further remolding as proletarian revolutionaries. Some commentators expect a critique of the liberal philosophy, but in very concrete terms, Mao hits the mark by criticizing individualism, which is the core of petty bourgeois ideology of various types. Thus, the article is disliked or even condemned by liberals, anarchists, Trotskyites, and other individualist and subjectivist trends that oppose collectivity, democratic centralism, and the mass line in the revolutionary struggle.
So you say that commentators expect a critique of the liberal philosophy, but liberalism may have different meanings to some people. Can you clear up what liberalism is that Mao is tackling in this pamphlet, in this text, and what is meant by that liberalism rejects ideological struggle?
Mao discusses as many as 11 manifestations of liberalism, which include the following. First, to let things slide for the sake of peace and friendship. When a person has clearly gone wrong, to refrain from argument because he is an old acquaintance. Two, to indulge in irresponsible criticism in private instead of actively putting forward one's suggestions to the organization, to say nothing to people to their faces, but to gossip behind their backs. Third, to let things drift if they do not affect one personally, to say as little as possible, while knowing perfectly well what is wrong, to be worldly wise and play safe and seek only to avoid blame. Fourth, not only not to obey orders, but to give pride of place to one's own opinion, to demand special consideration from the organization, but to reject its discipline. Fifth, to indulge in personal attacks, pick quarrels, vent personal spite, or seek revenge instead of entering into an argument and struggling against incorrect ideas, views, and ideas for the sake of unity or progress. Sixth, to hear incorrect views without rebutting them, and to hear counter-revolutionary remarks without reporting them, but instead to take them calmly as if nothing had happened. Seventh, to be among the masses and fail to conduct propaganda and agitation or speak at meetings, forgetting that one is a communist and behaving as if one is an ordinary non-communist. Eighth, to see someone harming the interests of the masses and yet not feel indignant or dissuade or stop him, but allow him to continue. Ninth, to work half-heartedly without a definite plan or direction, to work perfunctorily and muddle along. Then, to regard oneself as having rendered great service to the revolution, to pride oneself on being a veteran, yet to be slipshod in work and slack in study. to be aware of one's own mistakes and yet make no attempt to correct them, taking a liberal attitude towards oneself. As Mao has correctly pointed out, all the foregoing acts of liberalism within the party express or manifest the rejection of ideological struggle. And I wish to add that those who practice liberalism actually peddle their own petty bourgeois ideology and try to obscure their own need for Marxist education. They are not humble enough to acknowledge their need for further Marxist education if they are indeed sworn to develop themselves as party members. At one point in the article, Mao refers to some party members who think that they can adhere to liberalism and Marxism at the same time. They presume that they can flip from one to the other or even mix them up. There are such eclectics who even presume that they are smarter than others because of their eclecticism, but it is not really impossible to be a consistent, systematic, and profound Marxist by not discarding and combating liberalism.
Yes, very true. And I think this is something that is still very relevant today. I'm sure we'll get into that later on. So liberalism manifests itself in various ways. One example is to let things slide for the sake of peace and friendship when a person has clearly gone wrong, and refrain from principled argument because of personal relationships. This is particularly difficult in practice. There are comrades who do criticize and argue every wrong point. In organizing, it is tricky to point out every wrong view and opinion of the masses immediately, because we don't want them to distance themselves in the beginning. So how do we balance this, and how do we weigh which is liberalism and which is not?
When someone expresses a wrong idea, I think the person, if he's really an honest member of the party, would welcome attempt to correct the error. I do not agree that there is any wrong idea or any wrong factual claim from comrades and the masses that cannot be answered and explained in a respectful, friendly, and persuasive way. In the first place, we propagate the line that in the revolutionary movement, we learn from each other. It is wrong to let a wrong idea stand or pass just to avoid offending the one who expressed it. The Marxist knows how to answer or explain how wrong an idea or claim is in a reasonable and persuasive way without insulting or running down the other side in the discussion. In the classroom, there is the so-called terror teacher. I don't agree with the pose of such a teacher, intimidating the students and, you know, jumping on the student when he says something wrong. I have had so many students who even express rabid anti-communist ideas, but they have been intelligent enough to learn from what I explain. Sometimes even the apparently most rabid anti-communist becomes eventually an activist or even a comrade and devoted student of Marxism.
So Mao talks of irresponsible criticism. What does he mean by that? And in our organizations, in the National Democratic Movement, what are methods we use to conduct responsible criticisms?
Even among those who are already presumed to know the decisive importance and necessity of democratic centralism and collectivity in party life, there are some members who act and speak liberally or individualistically by making irresponsible criticisms at the expense of comrades who are absent or at the expense of decisions taken by collective organs and units of work. Those who come across such irresponsible comrades should admonish them immediately to bring the criticism before the proper organ or collective. They should also be reported accordingly. Thus, the criticism is looked into before any disunity arises that obscures the issue, if there is any serious one that exists.
So, not to obey orders, but to give pride of place to one's own opinions, to demand special consideration from the organization, but to reject its discipline. This is also a form of liberalism. what do we do in cases that where we do not agree with the orders given to us? How do we ensure democracy in our organization?
There may be views different from individual members, as well as even from lower organs and lower collective organizations. There is space, enough space within the party for such ideas to be expressed at a given level. But the most important procedure to follow is when a lower organ or a lower collective does not agree with an order from above, it must send up promptly the reasons and facts why the order is wrong and should be corrected immediately. It is wrong for any individual or even a lower organ or organization of the party to become swell-headed and break discipline. The higher organ is also cognizant that it does not have infallibility, or even the Central Committee has infallibility. It is open to arguments and facts that may not have been covered in a previous decision-making process. There is a dialectical and interactive relationship between higher and lower levels of organs and organizations. The higher level is ever appreciative of timely and more accurate reports, recommendations, criticisms, and new proposals. It shuns bureaucratic centralism and commandism. The communist principle and style is to work through the collective and follow democratic centralism.
To be among the masses and fail to conduct propaganda and agitation or speak at meetings, that is also a form of liberalism. Can you elaborate on this and give examples?
Every time a communist is among the masses, he must avail of the opportunity to conduct propaganda and agitation. There are always burning issues to take up, and there is always the need to raise the level of revolutionary consciousness and militancy among the masses. To waste the opportunity is to fail to perform a duty. It is a form of liberalism, a way of taking it easy and neglecting to carry out a task.
Okay, so let's I'll keep that in mind. We must constantly conduct propaganda in every aspect of our lives. So what does the saying, so long as one remains a monk, one goes on tolling the bell, mean, and why is that harmful to our organization?
This means doing the routine all by oneself and not taking a new initiative with other comrades in order to raise the level of revolutionary work to a new and higher level. Of course, there is a certain amount of routinary functions to perform. But the party member must always think of how he can give a new contribution and how he can work with others in order to bring the general level of work to a higher level. Being daily satisfied with the status quo and doing the same chores day in and day out run counter to the constant need for arousing, organizing and mobilizing more people for the strengthening and advance of the revolutionary movement.
To regard oneself as having rendered great service to the revolution, to pride oneself on being a veteran, to disdain minor assignments while being unequal to major tasks, to be slipshod in work and slack in study. This is also liberalism. How do we ensure that comrades don't fall to this kind of liberalism?
This is a case of liberalism in which someone thinks so highly of himself that he would disdain to do anything below his imagined self-importance, even as he's actually short of what he can accomplish, or does slipshod work and is wanting in further education. Such comrades who overrate themselves and underperform should come under the supervision and direction of the appropriate organs and collectives, as well as of the masses.
So Mao named 11 principal manifestations of liberalism in his pamphlet, and mentions that there are more. We recommend that listeners read the whole text. Some of those principal manifestations we've talked about today. Kajoma, can you explain where liberalism stems from?
Mao declares liberalism stems from petty bourgeois selfishness. It places personal interest first and the interest of the revolution second, and this gives rise to ideological, political, and organizational liberalism. Liberalism is a manifestation of opportunism and conflicts fundamentally with Marxism. It is negative and objectively has the effect of helping the enemy. That is why the enemy welcomes its preservation in our midst. Such being its nature, there should be no place for it in the ranks of the revolution.
So to conclude this first portion of our session today, can you elaborate why liberalism is extremely harmful to the revolutionary collective, and how can we battle and overcome it?
Mao teaches us liberalism is extremely harmful in a revolutionary collective. It is corrosive, which eats away unity, undermines cohesion, causes apathy, and creates dissension. It robs the revolutionary ranks of organization and strict discipline, prevents policies from being carried through, and alienates the party organizations from the masses the party leads. It is an extremely bad tendency. We must use Marxism, which is positive in spirit, to overcome liberalism, which is negative. All loyal, honest, active, and upright communists must unite to oppose the liberal tendencies shown by certain people among us and set them on the right path. This is one of the tasks on our ideological front. We can combat and overcome liberalism by studying Mao's combat liberalism, raising our level of consciousness about it, and being vigilantly and militantly critical of it every time that it is manifested. Mao prescribes the following. We stand for active ideological struggle because it is the weapon for ensuring unity within the party. But liberalism rejects ideological struggle and stands for unprincipled peace, thus giving rise to a decadent attitude and bringing about political degeneration in certain party individuals and revolutionary organizations.
Thank you for answering our questions, Tito. So what we can learn from all of this is how liberalism manifests itself in very different ways, and no one, we as organizers, as activists, are not immune to it. It is a constant process that we must remold ourselves and call out liberalism when we see it. So we'll be having a short break, a short intermission, and we'll be enjoying the songs of the group Buklod. One of the songs is called Maynila and the other is Kanlungan. And we will also be opening the floor for your questions. So just send us your questions, and after the break, we will be discussing those. Thank you.
Kapal na uso kang iniiwan. balik mo. Ikaw lamang wala nang iba. Sa dibdib mo ipipikit ang mata. Tahanan ng aking kamusmusan, Maynila. Ikaw lamang wala nang iba. Sa dibdib mo ipipikit ang mata. Tahanan ng aking kamusmusan, Maynila. Kamusmusan, Maynila. Ikaw lamang wala nang iba. Sa dibdib mo ipipikit ang mata. Tahanan ang aking kamusmusan, Maynila. Kamusmusan, Maynila. Ikaw lamang wala nang iba. Sa dibdib mo'y itikit ang mata. Tahanan ang aking kamusmusan, Maynila.
Bakit kailangan ding lumipas?
kalusugan, panapanahon ng pagkakataon, may babalik ba ang kahapon? Ngayong ikaw ay nagbalik, at tulad ko rin ang iyong pananabik. Makita ang dating kalungan, tahanan ng ating
And welcome back to our ND Line Online series. Today we are discussing the pamphlet Combat Liberalism with Tito Joe. And we just asked him a few questions earlier. And now we've got the floor is open for more questions. So just send us your questions and we'll be discussing them. So the first question we got to... Can you elaborate on the Trotskyists' critique of Mao's combat liberalism, and how do Marxist organization differ from them, from Trotskyist organizing?
Trotskyites, as a matter of course, hostile to Mao in the same way that they're hostile to Stalin, because the socialists, the achievements of Stalin and Mao in socialist revolution and construction exposes their bankrupt position. But to focus on the Trotskyites' critique of combat liberalism, it would be most pertinent to consider the critique of Lenin, the criticism of Lenin, or the criticism of Trotsky by Lenin. He described Trotsky as one who was fond of exaggerating the left position, that is, in the decisions of the Bolsheviks. He would take an ultra-left position by exaggerating, and it is a way of helping the right, no? Because of the exaggeration, and the left position is misrepresented, caricatured, and the right is supported. And Trotsky was an advocate of the freedom of factions within the party. So he was against the principle of democratic centralism. Well, of course, I've come across Trotskyite criticisms of Mao's combat liberalism as supposedly a way for Mao to put down his opponents within the party. And then the Trotskyites love sometimes to say, to accuse Stalin and Mao of bureaucrat capitalism. Maybe in the case of Stalin, there were instances of the too much bureaucratism, too much use of administrative measures to deal with errant members of the party. But in the case of Mao, he is a consistent adherent to democratic centralism. And previously, in an episode, we studied how contradictions among the people can be settled, no? And this is this article of Mao was written in order to provide a light and a light on the path of handling correctly contradictions within the socialist society, because also in 1957. Khrushchev and his followers were attacking Stalin for extreme measures taken against those who were off the line. So, the Trotsky sometimes use the term bureaucratic centralist, but when Trotsky was given functions within the Red Army, he was very much of a bureaucrat, centralist, a commandist. He would not listen to opinions of others. His tendency is to overdo what he thinks what is on the left side. So when he was supposed to be in the negotiations of the Brest-Litovsk Treaty, he did not agree right away to Lenin's instruction that as soon as possible the treaty must be done so that the Germans would be prevented from moving onward. No, and Trotsky pretended to be even more left than Lenin. So the Bolsheviks were at a disadvantage when they finally, when Trotsky stopped obstructing the position of having to make the treaty in order to allow the Bolsheviks to consolidate power within Russia. So the basic fault of Trotsky is not to follow the decision of the party, of the Central Committee, no less, even after a decision has been taken, after weighing the advantages and disadvantages, the risks, or the dangers of ultra being ultra left and being rightist, doing just the right thing in order to advance the revolution and uphold, defend, and advance the position of the revolutionary movement. But taking the ultra left position at one time, and then actually Trotsky would swing to the rightist position. So he's like an unprincipled person who switches sides. At any rate, he's a constant, constantly opposed to. He was constantly opposed to the correct line and decisions taken by the Bolsheviks. That is his record in the revolution.
And so our second question The temptation to fall into liberalism can be very strong, especially in cases when one's individual living conditions improve, such as migrants moving to countries with a better quality of life, like us here in Europe. How do we fight this temptation?
When people tend to be liberal, it doesn't necessarily mean that they are malicious. It could be that they have been used to what they are taught in school. No? When in the best education that you get supposedly is from, you know, liberal-minded academic institutions like the UP. No, so having democracy means always having an open mind and acting individually, and so. There is a good motive sometimes. It's definitely people become liberal not because they're malicious, and it's their way. There is a great deal of difference between an ordinary non-communist who is supposed to be open-minded and who acts according to his best reasoning as an individual. The revolutionary, the communist, is expected more than to express good opinions, no? Individually. He must have ideas and opinions and attitudes that are aligned with the revolutionary movement. He constantly builds up his adherence to the revolutionary line, and he keeps on trying to raise his theoretical and political level. So there is an expectation. But even the best of party members, they can slip into liberal ways. Because why? Because even within the party, that there are those influenced by the Puerto Bourgeoisie, and in society at large, there is always the influence, no? But it's good to be on guard against liberalism, because liberalism, especially when the party is already in power, leads to corruption, no? Or even before gaining power. For instance, the party has facilities, okay? The party has a car for use by a certain unit. If someone will just use the car for, nonsensical purposes, for private purposes, and the car as an instrument to facilitate work, revolutionary work. If the car is used only for partying and so on, no? In the revolutionary movement, sometimes it's good to relax, no? But then if you tolerate, because you are a liberal, a happy hour every day, no? Then you are going to have a frivolous group, no? That doesn't think seriously of what determined and militant actions to take on serious issues. And when a party is in power, party members do not recognize an abuse of authority, and they keep quiet because they would like the boss or a comrade to have peace with him. No, that's liberalism. When something is to be criticized, then the comrade should be motivated to make the criticism, so that something that is not yet seriously wrong at a given time will not become a more serious problem. So that's how important the party member must always think in terms of the interest of the collective, and the interest of the masses of the people. And they must to solve problems concerning the proper behavior of individual party members, the most important principle is democratic centralism. Bring up the issue before comrades, so that it can be discussed probably and nothing wrong passes, no? And after, you know, of course, on an individual basis, you can make a comment and an advice to a comrade that is doing something wrong, no? So, but then if the other comrade is hard-headed, then there is a basis for approaching the collective, no? And discussing the problem.
Yeah, I think this also is why criticism and self-criticism is such an important part of organizing or being in an organization. Our next question. We understand that combating liberalism is a never-ending process. Do you also experience liberalism in yourself or your work? In this case, do you have any tips in remolding?
Oh, yes. I do a lot of funny statements at home, no? And I'm careful that... but, you know, it's in the spirit of joking, no? I'm conscious, though. But doing that too much of the time, even at home, or you bring that, you bring out that style. It's nice to be sociable outside of the house, but too much of it, if sociability means, you know, making fun of yourself or And anyway, I make sure that when I make funny statements, it is my it is at my expense. No, you know, people tolerate me because I make fun of myself, criticize myself. No, so and that's the kind of jokes I make. No, and in a way, it's even self-criticism. No. But someone who listens in, no, and doesn't know the context, you would imagine that I was making crazy statements, no? So in moments of relaxation, I choose certain comrades. I exchange challenges, no, on certain points of ideology, no, and for instance, I have a comrade who. Sometimes he takes the initiative of posing a question in which he takes responsibility for the wrong idea, but he wants only to test, no, the idea, no. But sometimes I also use the same method, no. I pretend to, you know, to stand for a wrong idea, and then after an exchange, we laugh at how wrong the idea is, no. You know, so. But I'm not aware that I would speak out a wrong idea and then hold on to it as a matter of conviction or belief, no? I know when I'm joking, you know? As most of the time I caricature the ideological opponents, no? And I test their ideas by, you know, taking the posture of caring on their ideas and challenging others to provide arguments, you know. So I'm not always, it's not always the case that I'm the one answering the wrong ideas of the enemy. It's my way of encouraging others to join me in bring out the ideas to debunk the other side. Anyway, I do that. I love to use the devil's advocate method to bring out correct points against the devil.
Yes, I think the people here that have been watching these series with us for the past, over half a year now, I think they would know that, have noticed your sense of humor and the caricatures of your ideological opponents. I would like to quickly take this opportunity to promote the website of the Foreign Language Press, that is flpress.storenv.com. The address should be blended into the screen now. You can find a lot of revolutionary books there. Some of the, for example, the Five Golden Rays, which the text Combat Liberalism is in. There's also the selected works of Mao Zedong or the Five Essays on Philosophy. We also have from Tito Jo, for example, the Specific Characteristics of Our People's War. And yeah, just a lot of different awesome books. So check that out. All right. And the next question. Does failing to open up to your organization about your personal life, is that also a form of liberalism? What is the relationship of the personal to the political?
There are certain considerations why I'm careful about talking too openly about my family life, for instance, because I'm used to, you know, conditions of the underground, keeping discreet facts so that the facts could about my family would not leak to the enemy, and connections would be damaged. No? So, but you know, the organs concerned about my personal data would know all about me. Because, you know, we are supposed to present our bio data to the concerned or appropriate organ of the party and the organization to which you belong. So I think in my case there's discipline, but you must observe that I don't talk much about my children. I don't post their pictures too often. I post their pictures sometimes in the Facebook, but they themselves do not want to be too much open up to others, no? So I respect their desire to have privacy, no? So that is a choice by them, and I agree with them. The of course, you know, what is there are things that are personal, no? They become political only if it is damaging, if it has an adverse effect to political work. For instance, you don't talk much about your sexual relations with your wife, no? Or if you are if you have no spousal relationship, you don't talk much about your sexual relations with your girlfriend, no? Or in the proper collective and in the proper meeting, you do discuss your sexual relations, a very personal matter, with your loved one. In general, as a matter of, for instance, if one has a girlfriend or a boyfriend, the party would be interested in the, raising the level of political education of the other party, no? So, the party respects sexual love, no? As Engels would often insist, sexual love is a form rather than relationship that is dictated and upon and preconditioned by property and class considerations, no? But in the case of party members courting another person or maintaining good relations within the family with one's wife and so on, the party is interested that such relations, family relations, are well maintained if there's already a family, and the courtship is done properly so that there is mutual development of the party member and the other party member or not yet party member, in order to no one become an obstruction to the revolutionary work of the party member. So I think there are many things that are personal, and by implication, if they need to be spelled out as helpful to the revolutionary movement, why not? Why not mention it as an asset? For instance, let us say you are a party member and you have a relative in the armed forces, reactionary armed forces, and you have heard him talking against Duterte. It would be important for the party to know that there is such a relative of a party member. It's good to know what's going on within the ranks of the enemy. So that's something you cannot just close that as something as something personal, no. But it is something useful for building united. Building alliances, you know, against the Duterte regime. And then when a positive things in your personal affairs become adverse to your revolutionary work, you also present the problem to the collective so that the proper decision can be taken. So the most important guide is, are you keeping just to yourself an information just to have, just to keep a face to other people, and you do not do the correct thing in order to make others aware that you have a problem that can damage your work, no? So you have to measure the negative side of anything, of any personal matter that can affect your political work.
Yes. Liberalism stems from petty bourgeoisie, but a lot of liberal tendencies also can come from feudal culture. This is why the peasant class also has a lot of liberal tendencies. Do you agree? What do you think about this?
Yeah, if you consider liberalism as a serious philosophy that arose with the liberal democratic revolution, with the French Revolution as the first glorious manifestation of change against the feudal system, then you must recognize that liberalism is indeed an ideological product of the petty bourgeoisie, and its core is really individualism. And it is the petty bourgeois. The petty bourgeois liberal is dishonest about it without being aware of the dishonesty most of the time. He thinks, liberalism to the bourgeois liberal thinks that it's something universal, applicable to everyone. It has something to do with political equality, no? And glossing over, class differences in society. The petty bourgeois raised the flag of the raised the rags of the poor as the flag of the liberal revolution. You must remember that in order to win political power. The petty bourgeoisie in the French Revolution, the Jacobins, invoked. They had to arouse, organize, and mobilize the plebeians as well as the peasants against the feudal nobility. And that's what they did, no? And contradiction should follow eventually. Of course. the leaders of the Jacobins would overstretch themselves, and some of them on the left side exaggerated their actions, leading to the French Terror, and then the bourgeoisie would hit back using the Directorate and then the Napoleonic coup d'etat. So, and the difference between the common people, especially the proletariat on one side and the bourgeoisie, would become clear. And but it would take another period. It would be in the Industrial Revolution that the proletariat would grow into a class that can really challenge the bourgeoisie. So if you understand the background of liberalism as part of the advance of humanity and the high road of civilization, with the bourgeoisie rising up against feudalism and trying to get the support of the poor, the poor plebeians and the peasants. There is also a significant amount of individualism and liberalism among the peasants, particularly among the rich peasants, Mao's writing. Sometimes the rural, the rich peasants are described as the rural bourgeoisie. But actually, they're more strictly speaking, they're the rural petty bourgeoisie. As in France, the rich peasants arose from the land reform undertaken in the French Revolution, and Napoleon respected the land reform carried out. So the rich peasant in France became a distinct force, and this would be a major source of liberal and individualistic influence. They have means of their own. That's why they can be independent. They can express ideas independently, although the class character is that of the petit bourgeois or even bourgeois. Liberalism has its social roots, not only in the intelligentsia, not only in the bankrupted guild masters or in the among the rich peasants. Those are the various social bases of liberalism. When people have their own means of production, small means of production, then they can express ideas. So what have I named as the basis of individualism or liberalism? The intelligentsia, the artisans, and the rich peasants. So, and in Philippine society, it's understandable that these are significant portions of Philippine society, so they have an influence. For instance, among people who can travel and get jobs, even as wage earners abroad, many of them come from the peasantry. The rural, usually that part of the peasantry, the rich peasants that can send children to school up to beyond high school, who can speak a certain amount of English, and they could go abroad to work, no? So if you meet a lot of people with a certain amount of individualism, and you know, they have a decent and reasonable objective in working abroad. They have to mind their work. They have to earn, because otherwise they cannot stay. And I think that's a legitimate interest. The point is to respect that and bring the level of consciousness, because Combine the interests of the wage earner and the intelligentsia are a very potent weapon against the reactionary forces. So would that be enough to elaborate on the answer?
Yes.
We can proceed to the next question.
Thank you. The next question. Do manifestations of liberalism differ between sectors, such as the youth sector, for example?
Oh, yes, there are different manifestations and tendencies between sectors among the youth. Let us say, let me refer to a small part. It's not but influential part, no? They are part of the youth that can get to school because they are children of the privilege. Privilege would mean they come from a tiny part would come from the big bourgeois and landlord, but you most likely you have people who look privileged because they come from well-paid parents in some administrative system. They may be teachers, they may be professionals, and so on and so forth. Among such urban petty bourgeois, you would observe a strong tendency among some of them to rise up in the system. They think they know the system enough to be able to rise up. But you can also find the people there, the youth, who recognize that their insights can be used to advance the revolutionary movement, and have contempt for some relatives of theirs who are not as motivated as they are in the interest of the people. No? So you find contradictory motivations even among such privileged people. Then there are those who, the youth who manage to go to school, even up to the tertiary level, because they work, they have to work as students. Maybe they come from working class family or even the peasant family, a middle peasant, or if they're not fortunate as the children of the rich peasants. So the youth that belong to the urban petty bourgeoisie are not surprisingly sub-centered, because they have the means. They have the means and the intellectual capacity to side with the people as revolutionaries, or to, you know, stay within the system and try to climb the social ladder. And we have to appreciate those who choose to side with the people. And most of them, because the urban petty bourgeoisie is so positioned, it's in the middle. Many of them can swing to the revolutionary side because the reactionary side is already in crisis, and the just thing to do is to side with the revolutionary movement. No, and aside from considering the objective condition that the ruling system is in crisis and is no longer attractive to the youth, you have to consider how good are the revolutionary forces in persuading the urban petty bourgeoisie to side with the revolutionary movement, at least as allies or as active revolutionaries that can go as far as becoming proletarian revolutionary. Yeah? The best, many of the best proletarian revolutionaries remold themselves, to come from the petty bourgeoisie. Marx was petty bourgeois in thinking until he was persuaded to become communist. And then Lenin, of course, he was the son of a someone who was highly respected as a teacher, and his parents were well-to-do, but by himself, he belonged to the urban petty bourgeois, and he chose to become a proletarian revolutionary. So if you belong to the urban petty bourgeois intelligentsia, you are right in the middle, and the choice to remain is among the choices that you can make is to become a proletarian revolutionary or to stay within the system, climb up the social ladder, or you try to ignore the developing situation. And you know, there are also people who don't think about the problems of the people.
Yes, unfortunately, there are people who don't think about the problems of the people. But yes, as we do encourage people to remold themselves and take the proletarian stance and become revolutionaries. So that was our last question. Thank you so much for answering so many questions today. And we will see you again next week on the 27th of December. And that will be the last installment of the Mao series. It will be at 3 p.m. European time, 2 p.m. British time, and 10 p.m. in the Philippines. Again, thank you, Tito. And we look forward to seeing you next week when the topic will be the Great Proletarian Cultural Revolution.
So I look forward to the next episode, which will conclude the Mao serie. I'm thankful to all of you, to Edna, and to all our listeners. And I hope that we shall all be together in the finishing the Mao serie.
Yes. See you all then.
Pagkakaisa, pagsulong, narito ako para sa pagwawasto. Pagdaluyong, narito ako para ang kalat-kalat na pulo magiging muon na buo. Para sa pagkakaisa, pagsulong, narito tayo. Para sa pagwawasto, pagdaluyong, narito tayo. Para ang kalat-kalat na pulo, magiging muon na buo. Pagkakaisa, paglaban, paghumpay. Sa daigdig. pagkakaisa.